welcoming Tony to the Hall of Fame is a pair of Spurs who celebrated four championships with him, Tim Duncan and Manu Ginobili. Tony Parker.
Sorry, I have a lot of French people in town, sorry. Got a big French mafia, sorry. Wow, thanks the Hall of Fame, Water Class 2023. Unbelievable, I have a lot of connection with that class. Pau Gasol, my teammate with the Spurs, huge rivalry, Spain, France. Dirk Nowitzki, where's Dirk? Dirk, I went to your jersey retirement. You're a great friend, and Texas rivalry was fierce. Dwyane Wade, who played twice in the NBA Finals, and people don't know that, but he's my little brother, favorite player. So every time he will come to the house and be like, Dwyane Wade, like all the time. And then be like, man, can you stop it? You're my own brother. But we won one, so we're good. We're good. We're good. Becky Hammon. People don't know that, but she's like my big sister. We have a great relationship. Thanks for all your advice through the years. And I'm so happy to go to the hall with you. It's crazy. Coach Pop, I was told that it was the first time that a player and a coach going at the same time to the Hall of Fame, so that's pretty cool. For the rest, yes, I can't get rid of him, it's crazy. For the rest of the inductees, it's an honor to go with you guys in the Hall of Fame, thank you. So, my presenters, Tim Duncan, I start writing my speech last week. And I was trying to think, like, why Timmy so special? Why Timmy so special? Like, it was like I couldn't sleep, you know, why Timmy so special? And at the same time, it's easy, and at the same time, it's hard. So I will start with the obvious. To me, he's the best power forward ever. Yeah. That's the obvious. But me, what I know, he has a special power, superpower with his eyes. I'm going to explain. He never talked to get the ball, never. He'll just look at me. And when you're 19 years old, coming from France, it's very scary when Tim Duncan looks at you. I play with a lot of teammates who will complain to get the ball, you know, oh, Bruce Bowen, like, oh, Tony, I'm open. Tony, I was open in the corner, you know, I'm like, but, hey, what's up, Bruce? But Timmy will just look at me, and I'll go to Pop. I'm like, Pop, you give me the look. And then Pop will be like, you really look at you? I was like, yeah. If you want a point guard tomorrow, we need to call a play for him right now. And so that's why, to me, Timmy is special, and he's one of my presenters. Manu is unique. Manu is unique. He's the most unique player I ever played with. And he was so unique that Pop didn't even know what to do with him these first 2 years. It was very priceless as a point guard to see Pop's faces after some of his passes. Because with Manu, you have two passes. You have the legend one that everybody will talk about. It was unbelievable. And the one that go to the fans, to the stands, you know what I mean? Pop's favorite. It was a lot of those in the first 2 years. So we had a rough start, you know, with Manu. And a rough beginning, you know, with Argentina too. You know, the Argentina media, they thought like I didn't like Manu. I don't pass the ball enough to Manu. But I never really understand that because Pop is the coach. it's not my fault if Pop calls all the plays for Timmy and Timmy will take all the shots. I'm just the point guard. So I needed an ally, and Manu was my ally at the beginning. So everybody knows that, but I'm going to say it again. My rookie year, Timmy didn't talk to me my rookie year. And people think I'm crazy when I say that, but it's true. Timmy don't like French people. Okay? He doesn't like my French accent. Is it not until I play against Gary Payton, who's one of my favorite point guards. Where's Gary Payton? Where's Gary? Gary! Love you. It's not until I play good in my rookie year against Gary Payton, finally say one word. Actually, two words. Three words. I don't remember. Basically, we'll be all right. So, we're all good now. A little Frenchie, a little guy from Argentina, and a swimmer from the islands. Who knew? We won four championships together, and it was an honor to play with you guys. So my journey started with a big dream. I wanted to dream big. And I wanted to go in the NBA, and I wanted to become the first European point guard to make it in the NBA. And I always tell my kids, dream big. And when you say your dream to somebody, and he's not laughing at you, you don't dream big enough. And so when I was in France, they would always say, oh, you're too small, you're too skinny, you will never make it. But I'm the one who's laughing now. I had a great family. My dad is from Chicago. My mom is from the Netherlands, Amsterdam. I'm born in Belgium, but I'm French. So, go figure. I grew up with both cultures. I felt like I had the best of both worlds, and it helped me a lot for my journey. To my dad, I love you, Timon. To my mom, she was a health doctor, helped me a lot for the longevity of my career. I love you very much. Thanks for everything. To my two brothers, TJ and Pierre. Those guys will do anything for me. I love you guys. To Josh and Liam, my two kids, I love the way you are. You have great hearts. I can't wait to see what you're going to do in life. And I know it's going to be great. I love you very much. Yeah, they love the camera, just like Steve Nash kids. Remember, Steve? I watched your speech, you know, to work on mine. Yeah, they're the same. To my love, Alize, thanks for the support. I love the way you take care of me and my kids. And you have a pure heart, and you make me want to be a better person every day. Love you very much. I'm gonna say some quick thanks to my French mafia, my friends, my team. Thanks for all the support. Gaëtan, 30 years of friendship. Thanks, man, you're like my brother. MS, my big sis, thanks for always listening to me and being there for me. TT, I didn't have a big brother, but you were definitely my big brother. I will always remember when I tore my ligament and they were saying that my career was done. And you flew 48 hours after, and you were helping me, going to the restroom and everything with my leg. I couldn't do anything. You were always there for me. Thank you very much. Natalie. Natalie, it's very hard to find the words, but the only thing I know is I'm very lucky to have you in my life. Cut Killer, I don't know where you're at. You got to be the one who traveled the most to see me play. I will always remember 2005 NBA Finals, Game 7. Your wife was pregnant 8 months, and you still came. That was risky. Sophia, Hélène, thanks for making my life easier every day. Alexi, Edwin, Mathilde, Leo Bros, Lil Sis, love you guys. Matt, Tina, my boat partners. Can't wait to make more memories together. Xavier, Mayu, Vincent, Nina, Luciano, Christina, Bill Day, Augustine, love you guys. To my team, Steven Newman, you're the best. Didier Doma, I have no words. Thanks for everything. You mean a lot to me. Bill Braden, 18 years. I don't know where you're at. Love you too. Neil, Stefan, all of my Infinity Nine group, all of my North Rock Partners team, Rob, Sean, Donnie, thank you very much. I appreciate everything you do for me and my family. The Spurs, man. What an organization. It starts with R.C. Buford. R.C. R.C., you find me. You find me. And thanks for believing in me. Thanks for convincing Pop to do a second workout. I was definitely terrible on my first one. Thanks for convincing him. And I will not be here without you. Thank you, RC. I love you. And I'll put Sam Presti on the same group with you because Sam was there too with you. Thank you. Chip England. Chip England, you might be the only guy who watched all my shots my whole career. And it was very scary to me when you decided to try to change my shot to be consistent. And my first year working with you, I made the All-Star team. So thanks for everything. Obviously, I had a lot of great teammates. David Robinson, where's David? David Robinson, you were the original. You and George Gervin, Patty Mills, George Hill, Steve Smith. I can say a lot of my teammates. Bruce Bowen, you are a hero growing up in France. We were watching you with my brothers. You always took care of me, and you always had my back. Michael Finley, I forgot to mention you on my jersey retirement. Forgot. And I told you I'm not going to forget in my Hall of Fame. It's okay you're on the Mavericks side, but remember you won with us, huh? You won with the Spurs, you know. I will tell a quick story on Michael Finley. He's one of my favorite teammates. In 2006, he decided to come to the Spurs to win a championship, because that's what you do when you come to the Spurs. You want to win a championship. And in 2006, we lost against the Mavericks. So Dirk had a hell of a play, and we lost. And I remember, I will always remember, we were in the locker room, and you were crying. And I took that to heart, like you were crying. And I was like, man, we didn't do it. And so 2007, my only motivation the whole year, it was to try to bring you a championship. And I remember when we beat Cleveland, sorry, LeBron, when we beat Cleveland, it was priceless to see your face and that we got you a championship. Coach Pop, it starts with him. Coach Pop, you're unbelievable. You're unbelievable. I can say a lot of stuff about you, Papo. The way you cursed at me and the language that you used to push me, but I have my kids here, so I'm just going to keep it simple. At the end of the day, you threw me in the fire. I'm 19 years old. You, in 5 games into my rookie year, you put me in the back of the plane, you call me, and you're like, you're starting tomorrow. I was like, really? I was like, did you talk to Timmy? Yeah, because I was still thinking he didn't like French people, so I was like a little bit scared, you know? And Pop's like, you'll be fine. You starting, and the rest is history. You've always been a second dad to me, Pop. Everything you did for me and my family, I appreciate everything. Thank you, Pop. I love you. To the French team, the French national team, we celebrated 2 weeks ago. We celebrated our 10-year anniversary of our first gold medal, the only gold medal we won with the French team. And it was a great feeling. I always thought that if I didn't win with the French national team, that my career was not going to be successful. I was obsessed with winning a gold medal. So it's true. Sometimes I wish that Pau Gasol was not born, because I would have won a lot more gold medals, but sooner. But because of you, you push me every year to come back with the national team. So I had some great teammates, Rudy Gobert, Nicolas Batum, Jan Mahimi, but my two partner in crimes, Boris Diaw and Ronnie Chuyev, you made it worth it. You made it worth it every summer. You made it worth it. To the Hornets, I want to thank Michael Jordan. He was my idol growing up. He's the reason why I wanted to play basketball. He was my inspiration. I had posters of him in my whole room. And you know, people always say, never meet your idol. But for me, it was the opposite. It was unbelievable that now I had a great relationship with him and I can call him a friend. So thanks for Michael, and thanks for the Hornets organization. To finish, I feel very blessed. It was an unbelievable journey. I never thought somebody like me can experience something like that. So for all the kids who are watching, keep dreaming big. Thank you very much. I appreciate and love you all. Let's have a good night.
Is a three-time NBA champion, Tony Kukoc. Let's hear it for Pau Gasol.
Thank you. Man, oh man. What a night. What a moment. Gracias. Muchas gracias. Wow. Well, I stand before you with immense pride and gratitude as I humbly accept this huge honor of being inducted into the Naismith Basketball Hall of Fame. I want to express my deepest appreciation to the selection committee for bestowing this amazing recognition upon me. This moment is a testament to the support, guidance, and inspiration I have received from so many throughout my basketball journey. I've always remembered the moment that Jerry Colangelo called me in to tell me the magic words, "You're in." Pretty powerful moment, gotta tell you. I know my fellow inductees will remember it too. Congratulations to all of you. It's truly an honor to be in the same class. If you had told me when I was young, a little kid growing up in a little city, San Boi, El Llobregat, that someday I would not only meet Tony Kukoc, but that he'd be presenting me into the Hall of Fame, I wouldn't have believed you. And yet here we are, Tony. Tony was a great player, heck of a player, man. I mean, he inspired so many European players growing up. I looked up to you. You inspired me to follow your steps. I thought I was going to be a small forward, but I kept on growing and growing until I was 20. So I ended up playing closer to the basket, having to face Timmy and KG and Dirk. But who knows, maybe in today's game I would have been a small forward. Who knows, shooting threes, all kinds of stuff. Anyway, it turned out pretty good for me, so thank you so much for this incredible, incredible honor. Also wanted to thank my friend and role model, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. I think many of you know that he was going to be here, being also one of my presenters. Unfortunately, he couldn't make it. He fell yesterday under the weather. I just want to say, wish you well, hope you're well, Kareem, and thank you for accepting the honor of being my presenter. Man, so many people have contributed to me for being here, but no one like my family. My dear parents, who introduced me to the game of basketball, they both played at an amateur level, but they played. Thank you so much for all your teachings, for your support, for your love, never missing a game, never missing a practice, taking me to practices after your work. You've inspired me. Your commitment, your efforts, your sacrifices have fueled me and motivated me. Thank you, Mom and Dad. I love you so very much, so very much. To my brothers Mark and Adrián, and growing up with Mark was special. You guys have had the chance to watch his NBA career, and he was a special, special kid. From shooting hoops at our grandparents' backyard and competing already, he always tried to beat me. I always try to make sure that he knew that I was a big brother. He shouldn't beat me, but he did. He started, at some point, he grew up. We played for our country. We played many championships, won medals. We got traded for each other. Crazy. I think we are the only brothers who ever got traded for each other. And we experienced one of the most special things, I think, in our career, which was that jump ball at the All-Star Game of 2015 at the Madison Square Garden. You know, it was pretty special to share that. Truly unbelievable. Thank you, Mark. And my brother, Adria, wasn't particularly interested in basketball early on. He used to bring books when I used to play in Memphis, just reading his books, his comic books. He's the only one in our family that got a master's degree in business. So I'm very proud to have you both as brothers. Thank you. Love you. And I wanted to take a moment to recognize all the players. Some of you are here, coaches that have come before me, that paved the way, that built this amazing league. Thank you all for your contributions. I truly, truly appreciate them. Thank you. And being from where I'm from, you know, from Europe, Spain, I wanted to give a special mention to those first Europeans that came here, that crossed the ocean, that took a chance and opened doors for players like myself. Fernando Martin, the first Spanish player to ever play in the NBA, Drazen Petrovic, Sarunas Marcelenis, Detlef Schrempf, Arvydas Sabonis, Tony Kukoc, Vlade Divac, Dino Raja, Rick Smits. Amazing players. Thank you to all. I started playing basketball when I was a kid, when I was 7 years old, just having fun with friends at school, with my classmates. But then 1992 happened. You know, the Olympics in Barcelona. I was 12. It changed my life. The Dream Team showed us how basketball could be played. It made me dream of playing at that level, playing with the best of the best. And that launched really an incredible growth in the sport internationally. And the 2023 class is a true testament of it. So thank you to the Dream Team of 1992, to those teams, also European teams, that competed against them, you know, didn't do so well, but, but you know, it is what it is. They were pretty good. Then when I was 13 years old, my coach at the next team that I played, my first club team that I played at CB Cornellà, gave me a chance to play point guard for a game, teaching me how hard that position was. It was extremely humbling. Obviously, I struggled tremendously guiding a guy that was 5'2". And really quick, having to bring the ball up and down the court. But what I took from that experience is that at those ages, I think the importance is to teaching and growing, you know, not so much focusing on winning and losing. So that's an important message, I think, to keep, and especially, you know, at all levels in the world as we're trying to teach our kids to play basketball, girls and boys. A couple years later, a guy that I was guarding, he's a tough turnaround jumper. I'm like, coach, what do I do? How can I defend that? He said, nothing. He'll be, you know, he used to play, it was a guy from FC Barcelona. At the time, I wasn't there yet. He said, don't worry, he'll make it to the pros and you won't. I said, okay. Okay, I guess. We all face moments and comments like that throughout our lives and careers. But I've always embraced them, you know, allowed them to motivate me and help me grow. And then the next level, I went to FC Barcelona, where I played with many great coaches and players. Some of them have become great friends today, and a special mention to my good friend Juan Carlos Navarro, who was a special player, special talent, not just with FC Barcelona, but with Spain. We were great friends and great players, so I wanted to acknowledge him, because he really inspired me to be a better player at that time. Then off to the NBA. You know, got drafted 2001. Thank you for the Grizzlies for giving me the opportunity to play in the NBA, for fulfilling my dream. When I first arrived in Memphis, I was like, wow, a pyramid. Well, I guess all NBA teams play in pyramids here. It's kind of different, but, you know, pretty cool, I guess. Man, I still remember our first press conference with Shane and Will Solomon, that also got drafted with us. My English was very limited. I wasn't very comfortable speaking what I knew, which was very little. But I quickly recognized that my teammate here was very articulate, very smart. So I just had to follow what he said, right? So when the media asked us how we felt about the NBA, being in Memphis, first time, the team just moved from Vancouver, and Shane went first, obviously. I was smart enough to allow him to go first. And they wanted him. I mean, he was a fan favorite, all NBA, great guy. So I just repeated the last word that I understood, that I was able to identify, that he was electrifying. Sounded good, right? Sounded good. So thank you, Shane, for being here tonight. I love you. I'm proud of my years in Memphis. The work that we did, we set the foundation for what the Grizzlies have become. Some of those people that were there at that time, Billy Knight, Michael Heisley, Sidney Lowe, Mike Miller, Lorenzen Wright, Jason Williams, Stromile Swift, Hubie Brown, Jerry West, and Mike Fratello, I mean, amongst many others, obviously. Thank you all for everything that you did at that time during my career and for the city of Memphis. February 1st, 2008, Chris Wallace calls me to his office and gives me the news that I was traded to the Los Angeles Lakers. That obviously changed my life and my career. I know some people in the league were upset about the trade, but it happened, right? And that's where I got to know the person who elevated my game like no other, who taught me what it took to win at the highest level, who showed me how hard you had to work and the mentality you needed to have in order to be the best, the commitment you had to make, what it meant and what it took to be a leader, Kobe. That night, I joined the team in D.C., and I got to the hotel after midnight. He was texting me saying, hey, I want to come by your room, and I want to welcome you. I want to say hello. I want to welcome you to the team. I said, what? I mean, it's going to be late. It's going to be like past 1 a.m. You sure you don't want to wait for tomorrow? He said, no. It's not going to be too late. I'm coming over. I said, oh, okay, sounds good. The team had a game next day at noon, so all right. So he just wanted to make sure that right away, firsthand, I got the message. He said, welcome to the team. I'm happy you're here. Now let's go win a championship together. So I said, all right, I'm in, man. I'm in. Have a good night. That was it. That was it. No crap. Straight to the chase. I wouldn't be here without you, brother. I wish more than anything that you and Gigi were here today with us. I miss you and love you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Vanessa, for being here tonight. I'm proud to be your brother. Thank you. And an uncle to your wonderful girls. I love you guys so very much. We needed it all together. 2009, 2010, it was super special. I mean, that's what you work for, right? We've been talking about this the last few days with Dirk, with D-Wade, with Tony. So I wanted to thank the Lakers organization, the Buss family. Rob, thank you for being here with your family tonight. Linda Rambis, Mitch Kupchak, the amazing coaching staff that we had, my teammates, Derek Fisher, Lamar Odom, Andrew Bynum, Luke, who's here tonight. Thank you for being here, Sasha. Jordan, Trevor, Meta, I'm so grateful to all of you. I hope that that you take this honor that I'm receiving today as part of your own. Without you, I couldn't have done it. A special thank you to Phil Jackson. What a truly incredible man. Besides showing us how to play the triangle, I think the most important things were what he taught us about mindfulness, about meditation, about blocking the noise. Encourage us to read, cultivate our minds. Thank you, Phil, for that. Then I had the chance to go to Chicago, the team that we grew up pretty much all idolizing and following, the Bulls. Played 2 years for the Bulls. Got to know an amazing city. Thank you, Jerry and Michael Reinsdorf, for being here tonight. Very special 2 years. From there, I signed with the Spurs, the San Antonio Spurs. What an amazing franchise. Pop, Becky, Tony, Manu. I mean, one of the things that Pop told me during free agency, and I talked to Timmy, I talked to Manu, they're strong, right? Their pitch is really strong. Said, think about the guys that you're gonna spend time with. Think about the guys that you're gonna be in the bus with and the plane with. And it's true, right? We spend a lot of time with teammates in our teams. So I just love the opportunity to play with you guys. It was truly an amazing experience, and I'll always forever be thankful. Thank you, RC, also for the opportunity. My wife and I will always cherish those 3 years in San Antonio. We had so many great memories, and we'll forever love them. I learned so many things about Pop. Obviously, the basketball stuff, you know, the good to great, play harder and smarter than your opponent for 48 minutes, all that good stuff. It's very important. But I'll never forget one of the things that he said that I will take with me, and I've taken with me and I've applied. It was Valentine's Day, and he asked, did you guys get your significant other's flowers? And some of us proudly said, yes, absolutely, yes, for sure, of course. And he followed up with, well, why does it have to be Valentine's Day for you guys to give flowers to your loved ones? So I thought that was a very important message. Thank you, Pop. And lastly, the Milwaukee Bucks, where I ended my career. It seemed like the miles that I put on my body finally caught up with me, so, you know, it is what it is. Of course, you cannot understand my career and me as a player without my national team, La Familia. So many battles with friends. We made each other better. You guys pushed us to earn every one of those games. Against D-Wade, USA team, Dirk, so many battles against Germany. Representing my country was a big, big deal. Such a privilege. But today we're going into the Hall of Fame together. How crazy is that? And how beautiful is that? All right, I want to thank my agents, Arn and Steven, for guiding me throughout my NBA career. Thank you for being here tonight, both of you. Both are amazing. To all the physios, the strength coaches, the staff, the team doctors, the security, everyone in the organization that allows us to do our job. We couldn't do it without you, and we appreciate your job and dedication so very much. All the media, thank you so much for everything that you do, for giving us the platform to reach hundreds and millions out there. And I wanted to take a second to especially acknowledge my trainer, Joaquin, who's been with me for 20 years throughout my career, and committed to me to enhance me as a player, to be a good friend, and to prolong my career as long as I did. Thank you. Gracias, Nete. To my wife, to my lovely wife. I'm the luckiest man. Thank you, love. Thank you for being my best friend. Thank you for being patient with me, for dealing with my ups and downs, for complimenting me. You're the best. I'm so lucky to be your husband. I'm so lucky to be a father to our Ellie and Max. You're the best. And, you know, transitioning from the NBA to the next chapter is not easy. I don't care. We talked about it with Shane years ago. You go through a dip, right? You've got to figure things out. It's a big shock, especially emotionally. I was able to prepare for it, build things along the way. But still, you struggle. And having the support of my wife throughout this time has made it possible for me. So thank you, love. And to wrap up, as the old phrase has it, to whom much is given, much is required. I truly believe it. Those values, the pursuit of excellence, the drive to succeed, the love of family, the recognition to give back, the power of empathy, the ones instilled both my parents, both working in healthcare, home by Kobe, always wanted to be extraordinary and epic, and encouraged and supported by my beautiful wife and family. They're the reason I'm committed to working to make a bigger difference in our world. And I want to encourage you all to continue to find ways to join efforts, to team up, so our impact can be much larger. We have a unique opportunity to do so. Thank you all very much. Muchas gracias. Muchas gracias.
Tim Duncan, Manu Ginobili, and Tony Parker.
I gotta give a hug.
Oh, I gotta hug you? Okay. You guys sit down. Don't speak, just sit there. I tried to think of a word that would describe what this might feel like, and it feels even... Shush. And it feels even different than I thought it would. But for me, it's unimaginable. And that's not an attempt to be humble. This is unimaginable. And for anybody that's gone through this and felt it, it's not something you think about as you're growing up. It's unimaginable. I want to thank Jerry Colangelo, John DeLiva, the Board of Governors, the trustees, and all those who voted to make me part of this honor. As I look around and meet my colleagues with whom I share this dais tonight, it's a pretty crazy feeling to be included in that. When I look out here, I'm looking at all these faces that are legends. I'm not speechless, but I find it hard to find all the words to describe what's going on in my chest right now. All the pictures and the artifacts in the Hall of Fame. It's a long way from growing up in Sunnyside in East Chicago, Indiana, and going under Klein Avenue to Franklin Grade School, where I shot my first basket. Because we all remember where we fell in love with this game. And for me, it was there with that asphalt ground and that moon-shaped backboard. That kind of ages me, I guess. But I can't remember if there was a net or if it was that iron mesh thing. But it went in and it was done. I was seduced. Dribbling downtown East Chicago and going to the Catherine House to play ball, or going to the Gary, Indiana Armory to practice with Biddy basketball for Doc James. All those days and nights out on the playground at 39th and Broadway in Gary, or out at the Griffith Parks, those are the things that came back to me as I was thinking about standing here. And I know that everybody has their personal story, so I'll stop at that. But it made me ask a question. What the hell am I doing here? How could this happen? It's hard to describe. Because I'm a Division III guy, you know. Guys like Coach Hickson are my idols. You know, those guys, that's real basketball. I was going to wear my Pomona Pitzer shirt, but I thought Jerry would shoot me, so I didn't do that. I figured it out why I'm standing here. I have half a brain. It took me a few days, and I decided there were two reasons. One of them is a bit lengthy because it includes the thank yous that are appropriate, and the second one is really quick. But I want to thank Coach Vermillion, who would open the gym for me in Merrillville, Indiana, when I'd come back from leave from the academy, and so I could stay in shape. And he wasn't a basketball coach, he was a baseball coach, my chemistry and physics teacher. But he had faith in me and made me believe that I could play a little bit. Moving on to the academy, I had the opportunity to play for Coach Bob Spear, who was an iconic shuffle guy. I learned a lot of discipline. I didn't shoot very much. You took a shot about every 1.5 to 2 minutes in the shuffle, but he was a great man and was followed by another wonderful man named Hank Egan, who was a very underrated coach. He took over at the academy. I played for him on the junior varsity team, and he gave me my first job at the prep school at the academy as a head coach. Also, this will be hard to believe, but when I got to the academy, I was a little bit of a wise ass. And I know you all know that now I'm a totally mature, controlled individual. But he would boot me out of practice at least once every week and a half, just tell me to leave. And at the military academies, that's not a good thing for you. It causes a lot of trouble. But he was special, and he deserves those thanks. Then things get crazy. This can't happen to anybody. But I guess it began when I actually was able to try out for the Nuggets. I was 26 years old, and Larry Brown and Doug Moe were the coaches. Suffice to say that when the camp was over, Larry and Doug told me that it would be best if I got a coat and tie. And they had the vision. I know it was a tough decision for them, but they cut me and kept David Thompson. So I knew pretty quickly that it was over and started to on that path. Coach Brown, for some strange reason, when he went to San Antonio, he brought me along while I was at Pitzer and Pomona, which is called Pomona-Pitzer. People don't understand that, but it's two Division III schools put together. Wonderful Division III program, and I was fat, dumb, and happy. I had a couple of assistants there, my first assistants in basketball, really. Charlie Katsifikas, a Tufts graduate from out east here, and Lee Wimberly, a Stanford grad, who went to the Bolt School, law school at Berkeley. These two idiots accepted an offer from me for $1,000 per year. And Charlie, who's still the coach, so Coach Hickson can get after him for this, I also added to his contract, if he painted the dorms at Pomona and Pitzer, he'd get an extra stipend. And these guys both took the job. So I owe them a great deal. Started me out, taught me a lot, and we had great camaraderie. Why Larry took me from there, I'll never know. I didn't help him very much. But the odd part about it was that it was after a sabbatical year where, this is the incredible part, I got to spend an entire season at both Kansas and North Carolina with Larry and Coach Smith. And Roy, thank you. Where are you? Thank you for being so kind and supportive while I was there. We don't have to go through the details of where he put me and where I had to be, but a whole year with those two guys, that was like serendipity times 10. And I'm very, very grateful for that beginning. From there, from those purists, those people, Coach Smith and Coach Brown, that would teach from morning till night, and if you were in a rocker step and you were an inch off, they were on your butt. From there, I went to Nelly. That's a different world. Speaking of Nelly, he's in no danger out there in Hawaii for a couple of different reasons, but heart goes out to all the people out there that are suffering so much right now. It's a tough situation, for sure. Was the master of gaming the system. Coach Riley knows that, right? He knew what to do with matchups. He knew what the rules were, and he knew how to use them. He was a great manipulator of the game. When I think of him, I can still think he had like three or four guys standing at half court and somebody going one-on-one over here back in the day. He was a little bit different in that regard, but I love him. He's a great guy. I've been blessed with great owners from the very beginning. Red McCombs, an iconic figure, philanthropist, great man, brought the team to San Antonio and was a great mentor for me. He's no longer with us, but the influence he had on me was tremendous. Then General Robert F. McDermott bought the team and kept it in San Antonio when everybody thought it was going to leave. David had a lot to do with it staying in San Antonio. And then the team was bought by the Holt family, our current owners. Peter Holt and Juliana Hahn Holt were fantastic, and they set the tone for our culture. The demands, the standards that we're still trying to live by. At this point, on a day-to-day operation, they've turned it over to their children, to Peter John Holt and his sister Corinna, who I'm very grateful for in the sense that they've been just as trusting as their parents. They allow us to do our jobs. We keep them informed. But so far, they've sent me no out-of-bounds plays or anything like that. I'm really indebted to them. Our fans have been great, just like in every city now. What are you people doing here? Who invited you? It's a pretty large town, but it's a very small town atmosphere. And they think we belong to them. And we kind of like it because we feel responsible to them. So thank you all. We're going to continue to try to do our best. Thanks for sticking with me. I told you the first reason why I'm standing here is to take a little bit of time. But number two is that quick. So don't worry about it. Special thank yous. USA Basketball, Jerry Colangelo fulfilled a lifetime dream of mine by having the trust in me to coach the Olympic team in 2020 in Japan. And it wasn't easy, but it happened. And we won. And for him, I'm a servant for the rest of my life. I'm very grateful to him. Thank you, Jerry. Along with Jerry, there are a couple people that need to be mentioned. Sean Ford, he's Jerry's right-hand man now, Grant Hill's right-hand man since Grant Hill has taken over, and he'll do a fantastic job. But Sean Ford, for those that know him, this will make sense. For those that you don't, you might be fortunate enough to run into him sometime. He could be the athletic director at any college. He could be the GM at any NBA team. He could be the damn president of the United States. He really could. He's that special, and he works that hard. He's with the team right now. I think they played Slovenia today and in a prelim kind of deal. So Sean Ford is important. Jim Tooley is the bureaucratic guy. He's the guy that guides the whole thing. at some level, like behind closed doors that none of us ever see, does a good job. And then lastly, as far as USA basketball is concerned, is a big thank you to my friend Coach K. He was so supportive. He brought me in early to make sure that I got up to speed, knew what the heck was going on, and through the whole thing has always been there for advice and counsel, and I appreciate him very much. Bump, bump, bump. All those players, these are just four of them. And there were a lot of times where they were a pain in the ass too. But there's a whole lot of them. Some of them are here tonight. But to all those players, all the coaches that have been there, some of the my fellow presenters here, especially those that had a little bit of age on them like me, we've seen a lot of players, a lot of assistant coaches, physio people. A huge thank you to all of you. I don't want to make the mistake and omit, but without them, nothing would have happened. They had a little bit to do with it, but all those people, the work that they put in, the loyalty, the support is beyond comprehension, and I'm very, very grateful to them. Three people that have been with me from the beginning, from my first day until tonight, right now. There are only three in the whole San Antonio organization. And the first one is a person who should be standing right here. And without him, there would have been much, much less success. And that's R.C. Buford. PJ is angry because I didn't say his name. Oh, I love you. The second one is Will Sevening, simply trainer of the century. And our PR director, believe it or not, from then until now, Tom James, who... He has the unenviable task of muzzling me when I get on one of my soapbox deals here and there. He counsels me and tries to hold me back and tells me how much trouble I'm going to be in. But he's a special guy. I have a family. People think that I just do basketball. I don't really like it that much. I mean, you know what? Basketball doesn't love us back, does it? We use it like a bar of soap, right? It pays our bills. It gives us a wonderful life. But I don't remember it saying, I love you, Pop. You know, it's different. It's the family that is the deal. And my wife, Erin, of 42 years, was our center of gravity. She was our rock and made everything worthwhile and meaningful. In her place now, my family has done a great job of keeping it going. My son Mickey is here, artist, musician from Seattle. And I had a dream. I thought, is there a chance there's a team in Seattle? Is there a history in Seattle that we're missing? Where's Gary? Am I right? Come on, man. Seattle. I'm probably in trouble. I don't know. My daughter, Jill, who has taken over the mantle and keeps us all on the straight and narrow. She doesn't talk to me about trades as much as my wife did. But, you know, wives hate trades. You know, they make friends and everything. You say, I just traded Joe Blow. You're an idiot. Why would you do that? Those are great people. It's the business, you know. I don't care when I hear about your business. You know, these are people. That kind of thing. But Jill, you're doing a great job. You and Mickey, love you to death. Her husband, Christopher, is here. Mr. Solid, never up, never down, just steady. Appreciate you. Megan, my sister-in-law, she keeps us all loose, takes care of us all whenever she's in town. And then the stars of the show, and I know all of you out there know who the stars of the show are. That's the grandkids. That's the grandkids. Bridget, stand up, Bridget. Stand up, stand up. Come on. There's Bridget. I don't think you can see Finn. Finn, where are you? Stand up. Raise your hand. Hey. Hey. Okay. Okay. Isn't it the truth? You know, I tell my son and my daughter, I love you. It's not that it's gone away, but you guys are a little bit boring now. There's nothing else I can give you. You're on your own. Get out of here. Give me the kids. You know, that's what it's all about. So thank you for your patience, but that's the first reason why I'm standing here. The second reason involves one word, so it's going to be quick. That's great, huh? One word, and that word is duh. I've been waiting for this a long time. I'm not done. I didn't say duh was the end. I just said there's one word to describe why I'm here, and that's duh, those guys. Did you hear the little video where I said listen? Listening is important. I was tasked with the job to try to create an environment so we could have some success. You know, people, you know, you've got some good players, you got to do something. And I'm going to give myself credit. I did. You know what I did? I was there. I watched it all. I saw it, and I have pictures to prove that I was there while they won championships. And you can't take that away from me. I mean, I talked to David. David, he was good. You know, Coach Blair mentioned the word relationships, and I'm going to get to that because that's what's important. All those O's and X's, everybody knows the O's and X's. It's not brain science. Like, you know, when's the last time you had a new pick and roll play? It's all the same damn stuff. You know, Jerry Sloan ran the same play 77 times in a row, and nobody could beat Carl and John. You know, so that's all baloney. It's about relationships. And with David, it was... Okay, I curse. I don't want to curse. I know it's ignorant, but you got to be who you are because kids, hold your ears. Because players have great bullshit antennae. And if you're not genuine, they know it in a second. Just be yourself. You can't be Johnny Wooden or Bobby Knight or whoever. You can't do it. You just have to be yourself. So I made a deal with David, and he said, Pop, as long as you don't take the name of the Lord in vain, I'm going to try to put up with you. And I want to thank you for doing that. Because it worked. It worked. With Tony, I just asked him to be perfect. And at 19, that was tough. If you could switch the social, you know, situations that we have now compared to back then... If I coached him now the way I did then, I would be in handcuffs. Seriously, I would be behind bars, don't you think, Tony? But I have mellowed, right? He tells me I'm soft now. So I can't go back to those days. You got to change. With Timmy, the relationship was I just wanted him once in a while to listen to what I said or just nod his head. So that I knew that he heard me. I just wanted some self-satisfaction. I wanted to feel good about myself. I wanted to think that I was really coaching this team. And once in a while, he acquiesced, and he'd give me a nod. And I'm thankful for that. I really am. See, just like that. That's what he does. Relationships. Manu. Whew. Like I think Tony said, it took 2 years for us to figure it out. Was it that long? But what I learned from Manu, once he came to me one day, he says, you know, I'm moaning and groaning at him, and Bob, I am Manu. This is what I do. It's a true story, quote unquote. And at that point, I learned how to zip it and just let him play. And sometimes that's the best thing we can do as coaches, is just let him play. So my final message is just the wins and losses are all crap. The highs and lows are all crap. It's illusory. It doesn't really exist. What exists is seeing these guys and their kids, those relationships with your assistant coaches, everybody else you're with, your colleagues, your friends, because that's what you take with you as you move along. All those wins or losses, they fade away. They fade away. But those relationships stick with you forever, and that's where the self-esteem and the self-satisfaction comes. And we live in challenging times. I'm not going to go into it. But the times we live in require that we relate with each other a whole lot better than we do right now. So I wish you all well. Thank you.
And Teresa Weatherspoon, it's my pleasure to introduce Becky Hammon.
Woo! Lucky for you guys, I got family all over in Connecticut, so it's a short drive. So if they get wild and crazy, I apologize in advance. Just want to start off with some thank yous real quick. The New York Liberty, Carol Blazewski, Richie Adubato, San Antonio Stars, Dan Hughes, so many people that have impacted my life in such a positive way. I had a lot of thank yous, and it took up 15 minutes, so thank you, everybody. Cheryl, you know, you're up here because you were the female Michael Jordan. And, we didn't have role models, so I had posters of Michael Jordan all over my wall. Spoon, I picked you because you're someone who's been with me from the start. You've been up here. And from those first days of you and Vicki Johnson giving me and my 90s style bangs a beatdown in Liberty training camp to up here to the stage of basketball royalty, thank you. It's been a crazy ride. Turns out I'm super grateful for those bumps and bruises you guys made me tough. You guys gave me, you made me tough. And I'm even more thankful that Carol Blazewski, when she asked you who you guys liked, you said, that little white girl. We hit her hard and she bounced back up. I didn't know then, but it turned out I was going to need a lot of bounce back to end up here on this stage tonight. Thank you to all the other people to go into this class. I mean, this is unbelievable. To go in with all these Spurs, Tony, Pau, Pop, just I could go down the list. I've been fans and attempted to stop some of you guys. didn't most times, but we tried. But I had to write this speech over, like I say, because there are so many thank yous, and it was necessary for me to get to this moment. The thank yous are endless. To try to wrap up my 46 years of my existence and my 25 years of being either in a WNBA or NBA arena would nearly be impossible. Too many stories and friendships and court battles to even count. But to all my coaches, teammates, players, peers, friends and family, thank you. So I'm not going to give you the traditional basketball speech, because quite frankly, there's nothing traditional about me. So to stand up here and tell a bunch of basketball junkies that I'm not going to give you basketball is scary, because we are sick when it comes to basketball. For me, it's always been bigger than just basketball. To me, it's been about the people and the journey. Growing up in South Dakota with my parents, Marty and Bev, my siblings, Gina and Matt, never in my wildest dreams could I have anticipated landing here up on this stage in Springfield. Mom, Dad, you're not here tonight. They're in Africa doing God knows what. Hunting, killing animals and taking pictures and all sorts of stuff, but they couldn't be here tonight. But I can't begin to express the gratitude for all the necessary tools you equipped me with, the values you instilled in me, and the countless amounts of time and resources you guys have poured into me. You four people, whom I get to call family, are the greatest foundational pieces of who I am and where I am today. Thank you. I grew up in the Black Hills of South Dakota, and I had no idea my journey was going to be similar to all those backwood hikes we went on so many times. Up and down countless mountains, down to riverbeds and creeks, you learn to keep up or risk missing out on my dad's next adventure that he would take us on. I'm thankful for my upbringing in South Dakota and the amount of times I heard from people, "You're the first person I ever met from a Dakota," is now a point of pride. But that upbringing was designed and orchestrated exactly how it was supposed to be. Literally, I feel as though at times I was just snatched out of obscurity and put on this path that I could not have dreamt up on my own. I had a poster growing up in my room, and it was, "Know your ABCs to accomplish your dreams." And I read that poster almost daily, dreaming about becoming a great basketball player. And along with watching the Come Fly With Me video about 500 times, which is VHS days, you had to wait 5 minutes for that thing to rewind in order to watch it again. I dedicated my life to the game of basketball. I grew up being absolutely sure of two things. I love Jesus and I love basketball. And though it became very apparent to me early on, I was never going to fly anywhere with Michael Jordan, my dad did give me some good advice. And he said, "Rule the ground and not the air." And I learned that the best tools that I'd have was two things the world of the basketball professionals wouldn't see at first glance. I don't look like a basketball player. In fact, most times traveling with my team, I got mistaken for the water girl. I'm average height, I'm average speed on a good day, and I'm very just kind of the girl next door type of girl. But what the good Lord didn't give me in physical tools, he gave me a double portion of in heart, grit, will, and a strong mind. I'm going to use an acronym to try and articulate my journey, but most important to me is that you know how grateful and humbled I am to be here tonight with you all. This is so surreal to me. D is for destiny. I'm going to use the word dream. It's so funny that Coach went right before me, Jim Valvano, because some of his stuff was hit right to the heart of me. But D is for destiny. In so many ways, I feel like this basketball and life journey for me has been authored by someone else. I'm the character in my own story, but God had this path for me long before I realized that every moment of my life was in preparation for what was coming next. It is clear to me that God knew my end before my beginning, and then he backed up and began me. The psalmist said the days of my life were written down in the book before there was yet one of them. He made sure that I had gone through the necessary processes before he allowed me to reach such wonderful promises. Trust and know, I'm speaking to the kids at home, and quite frankly, everybody in here, that every moment, especially the hard ones, are what is necessary to get you to your destiny. R is for resilient. Being resilient is both a character trait and a learned skill. The tough part about being resilient is that you can only develop this skill through going through hard stuff. The amount of times I heard no or had a door shut was the amount of times I was going to climb through a chimney or a window. I was going to bust through something to get to where I needed to go. I was going to find a way, and pressing on became an integral part of my story. So I'd like to thank you, Jerry Colangelo, and the Hall of Fame committee for opening this door for me and for saying yes, because I was really not looking forward to breaking into this thing and, like, hanging my picture. So, no mug shots. So thank you for this wonderful honor. But in all seriousness, I wouldn't change the hard parts, because the hard parts were necessary to build the strength needed for whatever challenge was coming next. E is for encourage excellence. Encourage means to literally give another person courage, to give someone mental or moral strength to withstand fear or difficulty. And just like resiliency is matured through hard stuff, courage is found in the presence of fear and difficulty. And the word excellence, because I've always strived for excellence, but I was also blessed with being around people of great excellence. Pop, I'm not going to look at you. You're a man of principle and excellence. I know you weren't trying to be courageous when you hired me, but you did do something nobody else in professional sports has ever done. You display excellence, you expect excellence, and model how to become excellent in your everyday routine and how you go about your work. You spoke courage into me with a phone call as I was getting ready to coach that first summer league team in 2015. You said, just be you, you're gonna be great. And you've texted me that. I don't even know if you know how many times you've actually texted me that. Just be you, just be you, just be you. And you've changed the trajectory of my life and of so many other girls and young women. Thank you, I love you. Being a trailblazer is a very heavy and lonely trail at times. It's also super exciting and adventurous and awesome. There are many nicks and scratches and cuts that happen along the way, and luckily for me, I literally grew up in the sticks, so I was ready. I'm an outdoors girl, but in those times of frustration, difficulty, and sometimes fear, I had voices speaking encouragement into my life and reminding me of the excellence that they saw in me. Family, friends, coaches, peers, players, teammates in attendance tonight or at home watching, thank you for picking up the phone. Thank you for picking me up off the floor. Thank you for reminding me of who lives inside me and who goes before me, no matter what paved or unpaved path I am on. Your encouragement carried me to this stage tonight. Thank you. My grandma's 93. She's right over there. I love you. A is appreciation. I've learned that there are two lanes to choose from when journeying through life, a lane of appreciation and thankfulness, or a lane of taking an entitlement. I strongly encourage you to live a life of appreciation and thankfulness. Appreciation focuses on what you have and not on what you don't have. My Aces team had a motto last year, and shout out to my ladies. I love you guys. I am grateful every day to be your coach, but go to bed because we have a game tomorrow. But we had a motto, and it was, you can't outgive life and you can't outgive the game. No matter how much you give, this life and this game will always give you more. So you have to give all you have. It truly is a life phenomenon. It is better to give than to receive. So I stand up here with so much appreciation to every coach and player, every organization that I've been with and teammate who gave me an opportunity to play, to lead, to teach, to grow, and to love this game that has given me so much more than I could have dreamed of or imagined. To Brenda and our boys. You guys are truly what I'm most thankful for in this world. Caden and Sam. Like Pop says, you have kids, nobody comes to see you no more. Caden and Sam, you are the most treasured and greatest accomplishment in this life for me. The other day, I was driving them to the airport, and my youngest Sam says, Mom, why can't you come back to Texas with us? And I said, well, you know, I'm in season. I got to stay here. I said, you understand what I'm trying to do here, right? He said, yeah, Mom, I know. Make shots and win championships. And I said, exactly. Thank you for your grace in sharing me with the world and supporting me in chasing down my crazy dreams. Whether I win or lose, your hugs, kisses, and love are my greatest gifts of all. Thank you, and I love you. M is for mindset on the mission. Even when the mission seems impossible, have the mindset that is unshakable and immovable. Just because someone says it's never been done or that it's impossible to be done. I'm telling you, I'm standing here. I'm not supposed to be here. This is not anything I could have ever dreamt. But after I did everything that I possibly could do on my own, I know that God took what I thought was impossible and made it possible. Lastly, I'd like to thank Nikki Fargus and Mark Davis, who loaned me his jet, because I'm sorry, I love y'all, but I was not gonna miss a game. And we played last night. I'm gonna jump on a plane tomorrow morning and get home for the game tomorrow. But he made it possible for me to be here tonight, so thank you. He continues, Mark Davis continues, as many of you in this room continue to invest and bet on women, believing that we have potential to change the world. And it can't be an us versus them, a male, we need everybody. And if you're down for that struggle and that fight, the only way I know how to go about doing it is putting one foot in front of the other and walking up that hill. So, thank you. Remember your ABCs to accomplish your dreams, kiddos, and dream on. Thank you.
Jason Kidd and Steve Nash. Dirk Nowitzki.
For the last few months, yes. All right, there she is. For the last few months, two words have been running through my head. Thank you. Thank you to Jerry Colangelo and the Hall of Fame for allowing me to live with this feeling of gratitude for months now. Being on in the Hall of Fame means everything to me, so I really appreciate it. Thanks to the NBA and Adam Silver, the greatest sports league in the world. My career has been a long journey. All this became possible because I had some, I learned some qualities and some values that were taught to me by some very special people that were excellent teachers. And I would like to share my journey towards these qualities today, starting with this quality, and that's creativity. And the one guy that comes to mind is my guy, Don Nelson, Nelly. Fortunately, he's not here tonight, but he always saw the game different. And when I came in the league, there were not a lot of coaches that wanted a seven-footer to shoot three, so my skill set kind of fit perfect into his system, and I can't thank him enough. And he wasn't also, he was also very creative off the floor, and the stuff that he came up with in speeches, it's almost like pop. They're not kid-friendly, so I'm not going to say. But it always came down to me having zero talent on defense, and he always let me know that. And he was just an incredible basketball mind, and one play that always comes to mind. He always came in the morning to shoot around, and he was super proud to share what's the first play going to be. And one time he told me, okay, Steve dribbled the ball over, Dirk, you pop. Bradley, you duck in, and Dirk, you just throw the ball off the glass, and Bradley would catch it and lay it in. Sure enough, that ball went out of bounds, and we started the game going the other way. But anyways, thanks, Nelly, you're the man. Creativity is worth nothing without leadership, and the guy that comes to my mind is my friend Steve. I think we came a long way from those two brutal haircuts we saw there. You had the frosted tips you had. You know, who would have thought when we first started to play together that we'll be on the stage together? That is, means the world to me, and you were a great role model to me and the best teammate I ever had. So you were always positive. You always encouraged me. We worked our butts off at night, went back to the gym, so and you became a friend for life. So thank you, my friend. Next up for me was I had to learn my competitiveness, and who better but my guy, Jay Kidd. I will always remember when you came to us, you were, you know, already a little older. But man, you were a warrior. I remember you picking up guys at age 37, 38. You got picking up guys full court, 94 feet, hustling for us, making plays on both ends. And you were just a wonderful, wonderful all-around player, and we won the championship together. We have a bond for life. Thank you so much. I would have really loved to play together with those two guys in their primes, but unfortunately, I had to deal with what they gave me. But next up, we had creativity, leadership, and competitiveness. There's one quality that really holds a team together, and that's respect. That embodies the entire class for me of 23. I'm so excited to be a part of this class. Pau, Tony, D. Wade, I didn't always like you guys. We competed at the highest level, but there was always an appreciation of your guys' greatness. So thank you guys. And there's one guy in this class that we have the utmost respect for, and that's Coach Pop. I will never forget you. You wrote me a handwritten note when we won the championship, and what you and your organization did at my last game, I'll forever be grateful. So thank you, my friend. And again, to the whole class, it's an honor to go in with you. I'm truly humbled. Respect is a great thing if you establish it over a long period of time, and then you get the quality that's more important to me than any other, and that is loyalty. And the guy that, yeah. The guy that embodies that for me in his life is my good friend Mark Cuban. You have a huge heart, and you taught me a lot of lessons in loyalty. And I always remember when you bought the team and you came to your first practice, you said, let's play some one-on-one. I could play a little bit. So, of course, I drove left like I always do, and I dunked it right on your head. And we had a great friendship and relationship ever since. So thanks for everything you've done for me and for my family, and I appreciate it. Career always comes with change, and that's always sometimes difficult. To deal with this, it requires the following qualities. Donnie, you found me in Würzburg, and you always believed in me when nobody else did. So that quality to me is the ability of taking risks. Thanks, Donnie. Second, you have to master this perfectly. Coach Carlisle, thank you. You taught me how detail-oriented you have to be to win. Really, almost obsessive with attention to detail. And I got to say, I had to retire. I could not have done another shoot-around of yours. I got to say, but you made us champions, and we'll forever be grateful. So thank you. And the lesson there was nothing really works without great preparation. Coach Avery, you pushed me to become just more than a jump shooter. Yeah. You developed me into more of a complete player, and the lesson here is you made a difference with your intensity, and I'll always be grateful. Thank you so much. The next guy I learned his professionalism from is my guy, Michael Finley. You were a true pro on and off the floor. You let me and Steve grow alongside of you, and we will always be grateful. And, you know, I'm still sad you went to the Spurs in 06, but we've learned so much from you, and you became my big brother, and you're always there for me when I need you. So thank you, my friend. No one can whistle a symphony. It takes a whole orchestra to play it, and that orchestra, I was very lucky to have one in Dallas, and that quality was team spirit. And it starts with the whole Mavs staff, with the medical staff, everybody that does so much work behind the scenes and really helps us to perform every night. All my ex-teammates, I almost had 200 of them along my 21 years. Some of them are here tonight. Some of the guys from the 2011 championship team are here. We have Of course, I couldn't have done it without you. You guys carried me every night on defense, especially, and we have a bond for life. So I really appreciate you guys coming, and of course, all the Mavs fans. I hear you. I hear you. Everyone hears you. Yeah. You guys inspired and motivated me to always work hard, and I will always be proud to represent you guys and, of course, the Dallas Mavericks. So thank you. All these qualities I could have never learned without. The next one is innovation. And the one crazy guy comes to mind is my coach, Holger. I mean, you always thought outside the box. I mean, I had to walk through the gym in handstands. I had to play the saxophone. I had to play the saxophone while doing the handstand. I mean, what else can I say? You taught me everything from the jump shot to how to play. And, you know, early on, motor skills were always more important than strength training, and I think that that helped me in my longevity. You became my mentor for my entire career, and I will always be grateful for what you did for me. Thanks, Holger. Trying new things always leaves you vulnerable, and that's why you need protection, and that's the next quality. And I have received that from my sister Silke and her family, Roli, Lenny, Lila. You guys always looked out for me. You were always there for me when I needed you. And Silke, I'm sorry I forgot you to mention you at the jersey retirement. You know, it's a good thing you were only mad at me for a brief moment, and that brief moment is still going. Next up is something I learned from two people, and they're sitting here tonight, and extremely important message and quality is humbleness. And I learned that from my parents, Helgus and J-Dub. You obviously sacrificed so much and put your lives on hold so Silk and I can chase our athletic dreams. And to make sure you really understand what I'm saying here, the next two sentences are actually on my accent. They're German. So, was ihr für mich gemacht habt, werde ich nie vergessen für den Rest meines Lebens. Und wenn ich auch nur ein halb so guter Vater werde, wie ihr das Eltern für mich wart, dann bin ich glücklich. Danke. All these qualities are important, but the one really come into play is passion. And I thought I had plenty already in my career until I met you, Jess. Your passion for our family is incredible. You're so driven when you want something in life, you will work so hard to get it. Thanks so much for everything you do for our family and for our kids, and we're really lucky to have you in our lives. Love you. As you see, so many qualities and values are extremely helpful, but there's one more that adds a little spice, and that's curiosity. And I got the best three teachers here tonight. Those are our kids. Malaika, I'm here. Malaika. Malaika, Max, and Morris, please keep this forever. Stay curious and hungry. Find your passion and work hard. I think I shared with you some of the stories tonight that I learned from my role models, and I wish the same for you. Find your role models that inspire you along the way. It's always important in life to always have the drive to improve, to never be satisfied. Always see yourself as someone who wants to learn and not see yourself as someone who knows everything already. I've had so many great lessons taught to me by incredible teachers, and you will find them too. So remember, When you're green, you grow. When you're ripe, you rot. Thank you so much.
Welcoming Dwayne to the Hall of Fame is the answer, Allen Iverson, Dwyane Wade.
Heat Nation, y'all in here? I don't got much time. Coach Pop took all the time. Let me get to it. I want to start by acknowledging all the individuals and the amazing women from 1976 Olympic basketball team on going into the hall. Tony, Pau, Dirk, we were all linked together already, but being on this journey together, getting to know one another as men and not as competitors, it's been hella dope. For Dirk and me, it's been therapy. Who would have thought that we would be on the same team after all of our battles? But here we are, and it's one of the greatest teams I've ever been on. So thank you guys, man. I want to thank Harold L. Richards High School in Oakland, Illinois. I want to thank Marquette University in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. I want to thank the Miami Heat in Wade County. I want to thank the Hoop Hall. Here's my final love letter. The first memory I have of holding a basketball was when I was 5 years old, and it wasn't love at first sight. But one thing I knew for sure was that something inside of me would come alive every time I had that ball in my hands. I've got to credit my dad for my love of the game. He's what you would call an everyday hooper. If that was a court in Chicago, chances are my pops took my brothers and me so we could play against grown-ass men to gain their respect. If there was a basket and a run there, we were pulling up to the lakefront, Foster Park, Blue Island Rec Center, and any local gyms and parks anywhere in Chicago. The best thing about that time was what the game taught me. I had a chance to see the way basketball connected people just by hanging out with my dad, my uncles, and his friends. My love of competition came from seeing them go at it. It wasn't about anything other than their pride and the love of the game. If you've been around basketball long enough, you know how raw it gets. They had loud arguments about bad calls. You couldn't even think about calling a foul if there wasn't some blood involved. You had to play through it all. The trash talking in those games, it probably wasn't appropriate for kids to be around. But that's the game I grew up on. That's the game that raised me. After all those games, when battles really, watching them sit down, grab a cold beer, laugh and joke about any and everything, about work, family, and definitely who got buckets dropped on their head that day. You know, as a kid, all you need is an opening. What I lived for back then was any intermission in a game. It could be a long timeout, a long argument, water break, somebody getting pissed and throwing the ball over the fence, a break between games. If that was a chance for me to run on the court and grab that ball and imitate my dad, I took it. Thing is, though, at five, the ball was always too heavy to get to the rim or too big in my hands. But little did I know that this object was going to be the vessel that changed my life and my family's. By the time I was 9 years old, I didn't have to look far for elite level basketball. My hometown team, the Chicago Bulls, were the greatest force on earth. I look back on those days as some of the best of my life. All my brothers, Demetrius, Donnie and I did was eat, sleep, talk, think, and dream basketball. It was my obsession. The game gave me equal parts excitement and frustration. See, I was clumsy as hell back then. My hands were too big for my body, and my feet was growing just as fast. Before and after school, before and after my games, I studied the player who had replaced my pops as my favorite, Michael Jordan. He captured my imagination and fueled my aspirations all at the same time. I bet if you give me enough time, I could find that Come Fly With Me VHS that I watched before every game I played. The way he soared through the air felt like forever. He created moves that made me immediately rush to my backyard to recreate them. Game two of the 1991 NBA Finals, the Bulls versus the Lakers, and my dad's favorite player, Magic Johnson. Cliff Leverston drove baseline, threw it to MJ, who was waiting at the free throw line. He took one dribble. He took off with one hand like he normally does. And then he decided to switch it in midair to the left. I bet you can hear Marv Albert in your head right now. A spectacular move by Michael Jordan. After seeing that, I couldn't tell you how many days and nights were spent practicing that move. I wouldn't stop practicing it until I mastered it. I was hoping to bring some of his style into my own game. By 17, basketball was my soul's love language. It helped give me an identity. It was a safe space that allowed me to be expressive and passionate. I realized that basketball was my blank canvas. I used it to reimagine my life. No matter what was going on in my life, it was my sanctuary. It was my way out. I needed to reimagine life, not just for myself, but for everyone I loved. The game is where I discovered who I could become. It showed me that on the other side of hard work was the success I craved. It taught me the value of resilience in the face of adversity and how to bounce back stronger after a defeat. Through the game, I discovered who shows up for me when I win and when I lose. My confidence was found through the game. It helped me find my worth far beyond the court. You see, I've never been a stranger to adversity. I'm speaking of being labeled academically ineligible as a freshman at Marquette. At 19, finding out I'll be a father before my sophomore season. That season, my 10th game against Wake Forest, I tore the meniscus in my left knee. And at the end of the season, I had surgery to remove my meniscus. That was also 2007, when I had to have two surgeries at the same time. One to repair my torn labrum and my dislocated rotator cuff in my left shoulder, and the other on my left knee again. And finally, in 2012, right after our championship parade down Biscayne Boulevard, I had to have my third surgery on my left knee. Each surgery, each rehab, it pushed me past limits I didn't know I had. I could have given up. I wanted to. I never second-guessed myself. I third, fourth, fifth-guessed myself. But I never allowed my injuries to define me. I'm on this stage because my beliefs have always been stronger than anyone's doubt. So to all the hoopers, I hope you take this to heart. No, it's never about your setbacks. It's how you respond. The blows you take are fuel. The limitations people put on you are actually inspiration. No one who comes from the community that I have has ever left a legacy worth remembering by having it easy. As I reflect on my own destiny and the impact that my heroes have had on my life, I'm reminded that our heroes are not always perfect. Instead, they possess a relatability that makes them touchable and real. When anyone speaks about Allen Iverson, that's exactly what they say. He's real. So AI, I need you to know this. I watched you with awe because I saw a reflection of myself in you. The way you played the game was exciting and fearless. It didn't matter who they put in front of you. They wasn't gonna stop you. Shit, I know, I tried. It didn't matter what they said about you because they couldn't measure the size of your heart. Your authenticity and unapologetic attitude, it resonated with me. Your swagger, unique style from rocking do-rags, braids, the baggy shorts, to the untucked jerseys, the earrings, the chains, the throwback jerseys. It all combined to create an image that broke the mold. You challenged conventional norms and became the poster child for individuality and self-expression, inspiring countless individuals to embrace their own uniqueness. You brought hope to those who grew up with limited resources. You showed us that success and greatness were attainable, even in the face of adversity. Your struggles made your accomplishments that much more remarkable. AI, you are a living, breathing reminder that redemption and growth are possible. You inspired a generation, my damn self included, to believe that coming from nothing was not a limitation, but motivation. I wore an arm sleeve throughout my career because AI did. I respectfully wore the number 3 throughout my college and NBA career to represent the love and the respect that I have for this man. So from the bottom of my heart, you are the culture, and we love you, and we thank you, Allen Iverson. To make it here, the Hall of Fame, you never do it by yourself. I've had incredible mentors play pivotal roles. Their wisdom, guidance, and loyalty are as much a part of my story as anything else. They helped me discover parts of myself I never knew existed. You not only taught me the X's and O's of the game, but you also imparted invaluable life lessons that have shaped the very character of the man that I am. Your beliefs in my potential, your guidance through adversity, and your unwavering support have made all the difference, not just in my game, but in my life. I would have never evolved into the player that would have played, that could have played with the Mount Rushmore of talent like Shaq and LeBron without y'all teaching me about the importance of we versus me. That mentality made it possible to understand when sacrifice was needed for my teams to win. So thank you, Jack Fitzgerald, Larry Butler, Coach K, Tom Crean, Stan Van Gundy, Pat Riley, and Eric Spoelstra. I love you guys. Through all of my career, there have been many milestones, like the triple-double versus Kentucky to advance to the Final Four in 2003. We didn't get the chip that year. Salute to my brother Mello. But my Marquette brothers and I left a permanent mark on our university and college basketball forever. From there, I was able to reach five NBA finals with the Miami Heat. And win three. I could talk about my accomplishments and the work I put in forever. But that didn't happen without my peers, coaches, and honestly, you, the fans. Your cheers. Yeah. Your cheers and boos are a part of my life soundtrack. You made coming to work every night the best job in the world. I was blessed to play with and win championships with some of the best to ever dribble basketball. Teammates who understood how to play the game on and off the court. Overcoming challenges together, celebrating victories together, and creating memories together is what stays with me. Each victory was a testament to resilience and determination. Each loss, a reminder of how precious winning actually was. Being named an All-Star 13 times in my 16-year career, all NBA on both the offensive and defensive ends, I never wanted to cheat the game. And in return, the game gave me a lifetime of amazing memories. With all that being said, nothing compares to the bonds I've made along the way. I'm thankful for Travis Diener, Robert Jackson, Darrell Wright, Quinn Richardson, Caron Butler, Lamar Odom, Eddie Jones, Alonzo Mourning, Gary Payton, Antoine Walker, my bad little brother, Mario Chalmers, and Ray Allen, to name a few. I also played with people who protected me and gave me a bigger sense of purpose. Shaq, Chris, LeBron, and UD. They changed the way I would be viewed in this game forever. With Shaq, I learned how to be Robin to his Batman and then become Batman. Watching Chris simply be himself while giving his all to the game, but not cheating his family out of their time, gave me a friend I could look up to. Spent 4 years with LeBron in Miami. I watched him not take one single day off of being great. And my brother UD and I, we learned how to be selfless leaders together. But the protection that he provided me on and off the court provided the safety of a big brother, and it allowed me to bloom and blossom. So I thank you. I love you. Off the court, another blessing in my life is Henry Thomas. Being on this stage tonight, it simply wouldn't be possible without him. By job title, he was my agent. But in my heart, he was far more than that. If you're really blessed in life, you get to meet angels on earth. There's not a day that goes by that I don't hear him saying, "You got this, my man." I know he's looking down on me right now, chewing his tongue, with a proud dad grin on his face. Hank, we miss you, and we love you, my man. To my loved ones, the ones who have become my lifeline, y'all are my safe haven, a place where I can always retreat to with minimum fear of judgment. I've laughed with you. I've cried with you. I've been saged by you. I'm protected by you, and I'm loved by you. I am who I am because of all of you. You're the embodiment of unconditional love. And that's all I ever wanted and needed. And that's all I ever wanted to show in return. So I want to take this opportunity to recognize a few of my loved ones. And when I call your name, because we've been here all day, I want y'all to stand up so everyone can see your faces. Carmelo Anthony. If y'all can wait till I finish the names before y'all clap, it'll be all day. Chris Paul. Chantel Cohen. You may be at the top somewhere. I love you. There you go. Andre King. Richard Ingram. Bob Metellus. Lisa Metellus. Tracy Union. Tregeal Wade Johnson, Davion Morris, Kavia James, Zaire Wade, and Zaire Wade. Thank you all for being there for me and for loving me in the most perfect way possible. I appreciate you guys and I love y'all. Thank you. Y'all can sit down now. And my wife, Gab, would you please stand? Thank you for making our house a home. Thank you for making sure our kids feel seen, heard, and protected when I'm not around. Thank you for learning every ref's name in the NBA. And for screaming at them so I didn't have to. Saved a lot of fine money. I know I'm traveling for work this year during our anniversary. So I want to say thank you for being on this journey for me, with me, these past 15 years. Thank you for learning to love my imperfections just as much as we've enjoyed and loved the moments of perfection. I love you. Mom, would you please stand? Your strength to overcome your own personal adversity is something I've always admired about you. To have a mother who loved me enough to know when it was time to allow my dad to step in and lead the way is one of the most unselfish acts I've ever witnessed. Thank you for seeing me and not making my life about you. It allowed me to blossom in an environment that kept me focused and dreamy. Thank you for showing me that our lives don't always go as planned, but with the right amount of love and support, our lives do go exactly as planned. I love you. Pops, would you please stand? I started this off thanking you, and I want to end it the same way. I owe you a debt of gratitude that I'll never be able to repay. When I would cry and say I can't, you made me go harder. You pushed me to limits that I didn't know were inside of me. The hard work I put in was because I didn't want to let you down. Those countless hours in the backyard, where we would compete against each other like strangers, it built me to last. Those days that turned into late nights of me working on my left hand, so it was just as good as my right, it made me an unstoppable force. That time you got kicked out of the game as my coach and snuck back in the side door and coached me from the stands just to get kicked out again, it showed me that there was no limitations on how you would show up for me. It's the exact same way I try to show up for my kids. So even though I hated being called Little Dwyane, I admired you as a kid. I admire you now. We had the same exact dream, and we carry the same exact name, Dwyane Tyrone Wade. To know we hustled all the way to the Basketball Hall of Fame is God's will. So Pops, I know your knee's a little sore, but will you join me on stage as we take our rightful step into basketball heaven? This one right here, this one is for my father. I love you, and I'm thankful for you.
I love you too, man.
We in the Hall of Fame, dog.